Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Robin Williams, American Master, The Movies and Art of a Lost Genius, by Stephen Spignesi, narrated by Roger Wayne. Spoilers abound, ye who enter here. Dear reader, Robin Williams' American Master contains detailed, all-revealing synopses of all of Robin's movies. If you haven't seen a particular film yet and do not want it to be spoiled, then skip that chapter until after you've seen the flick. Introduction. Legalized insanity. You're only given a little spark of madness. You mustn't lose that madness. Robin Williams. Performing and acting? One is hang gliding, the other oil drilling. With live comedy, the total freedom you have to go from the Ottoman Empire to Madonna is incredible. With acting, you have certain constraints. What do I like more? Sure, I like performing full out. Robin Williams, in the New York Times, May 28, 1989. The title of this introduction comes from Robin's oft-repeated use of the phrase legalized insanity to describe what he does for a living. We can most appreciate genius in all its forms through an artist's body of work over his or her lifetime. Here is a brief biography of Robin, with a few pithy comments by Mr. Williams himself, from his October 1982 interview with Playboy. Robin Williams was born in Chicago, Illinois, on Monday, July 21, 1952. He went to elementary school in Lake Forest, Illinois, and a private day school in Birmingham, Michigan. When his father retired from Ford, the family moved to Tiburon, California, north of San Francisco. Robin graduated from Redwood High School in Marin County in 1969. All my friends were Jewish, which is why I know so much Yiddish. I went to 14 bar mitzvahs in less than a year, and it was great. My friends made me an honorary Jew and used to tell people I went to services at Temple Beth Dublin. Robin briefly attended Claremont College and College of Marin while trying out his licks in comedy clubs around Los Angeles and San Francisco. I played a lot of tiny clubs like the Holy City Zoo in San Francisco. I met Valerie there, and the Salamander in Berkeley. This period served as a time of learning and comedy experimentation for Robin. In the beginning, you find yourself doing a lot of drug humor, and when you can't be funny, you can get some laughs by saying motherfucker a lot. One of the initial reviews I got tore me up, because it said I was a scatological pubescent, and that was true. It hit me right on the nose. In the beginning, you're also imitating everybody you've ever seen. Well, for me, it was touches of Winters and Pryor. But all of a sudden, you get to a point where you go, ah, I can be me. I can develop my own stuff. Robin eventually moved to New York. I got there in September of 73. One of the first things I learned was the Brooklyn alphabet. Fucking A, fucking B, and fucking C. I was the walking epitome of first year meets your ass. My first week there, I was in a bus going uptown to see an apartment when an old man two seats in front of me suddenly collapsed and died. He slumped over against a woman sitting next to him, and she said, "Get off me," and moved away. Somebody told the driver what had happened, so he stopped the bus and ordered everybody off, but I wanted to stay and help. The driver told me, "He's dead, motherfucker. Now get off. You can't do shit for him, so take your raggedy California ass and get out of my bus." I knew that living in New York was certainly going to be different. Robin studied at the Juilliard School for 3 years. At Juilliard, John Houseman was one of Robin's instructors, and Chris Reeve, one of his classmates. Me and Chris Reeve had come in together as advanced students. Chris had gone to Cornell, and we had to catch up to the other students who'd been at Juilliard for a year. Chris lived about five blocks away, and we used to go up to the roof of his apartment building and drink cheap wine and talk about present and lost loves. Except for my friendship with Brother Reeve, that first year was rough, especially at Christmas time. When I came back to Juilliard the following fall, Chris had left to do a soap opera. After Juilliard, Robin auditioned for Happy Days in 1977, and his Mork from Ork character was spun off and given his own show, Mork and Mindy, on September 14, 1978, and the rest is history. As to Robin's personal life, he married Valerie Velarde on June 4, 1978, and they had one son, Zachary. They divorced 10 years later, and on April 30, 1989, Robin wed Marcia Garces, with whom he had two children, Zelda and Cody. They divorced in 2010. On October 22, 2011, Robin wed his third wife, Susan Schneider. They were married at the time of his death in 2014. Robin Williams truly loved his work. He was more productive and more successful than many other actors who had been in the business twice as many years. His death diminished the world. We'll give the final words to Robin. When in doubt, go for the dick joke. People say satire is dead. It's not dead. It's alive and living in the White House. I went to rehab in wine country just to keep my options open. Men wearing pants so tight that you can tell what religion they are. Taking Viagra after open heart surgery is like a Civil War reenactment with live ammo. Not good. If it's the psychic network, why do they need a phone number? The definition of pornography is quite simple. Erotic is using a feather. Pornography is using the entire chicken. If on your tax form it says $50,000 for snacks, mayday, you've got yourself a cocaine problem. Stephen Spignesi, New Haven, Connecticut, January 1, 1997, and January 1, 2020. Foreword, Boss, a TV series starring Kelsey Grammer and why it's relevant to Robin Williams's story. The first episode of this 2011 to 2012 TV series was directed by Gus Van Sant and revealed that the mayor of Chicago, Tom Kane, played by Kelsey Grammer, was suffering from dementia with Lewy bodies, also known as Lewy body dementia, LBD. And Lewy body dementia was the disease that killed Robin Williams. No one, however, including his wife Susan, knew he had it until 3 months after his death, when the diagnosis was confirmed during Robin's autopsy. According to the Mayo Clinic, symptoms of LBD include visual hallucinations, changes in alertness and attention, and Parkinson's disease-like signs and symptoms, such as rigid muscles, slow movement, and tremors. What does LBD do to a person? Robin's wife Susan described it succinctly in an essay she wrote for the medical journal Neurology. Robin was losing his mind, and he was aware of it. Can you imagine the pain he felt as he experienced himself disintegrating? And not from something he would ever know the name of or understand. Neither he nor anyone could stop it. No amount of intelligence or love could hold it back. In Boss, Tom Kane knew what he had and chose to cover it up. He obtained the medications used to ameliorate some of the symptoms clandestinely, and even though we, the audience, saw the hallucinations he experienced, he pretended everything was fine. Robin Williams never knew what he had. He was treated for Parkinsonian symptoms, but the medications did nothing for the visual hallucinations, delusional thinking, paranoia, and other LBD symptoms. Would it have made a difference if Robin knew what he had? We don't know, and it's futile to speculate. Can I do it till I need glasses? 1977. Q. What role or movie of yours would you most like to forget? Robin Williams. A movie I did years ago called Can I Do It Till I Need Glasses? From a live interview on America Online on Monday, August 5, 1996. As the epigraph above reveals, this 1977 film bears the notoriety of being the only project Robin Williams wishes he had never done. So how bad is it, and what exactly does Robin Williams do in Can I Do It Till I Need Glasses that he was so ashamed of? Not much, really. Can I Do It Till I Need Glasses is a vaudevillian-style review of skits that are nothing more than the acting out, with sets and props, of raunchy sex jokes that have been around forever. You know the type. A woman in a robe comes out of the bathroom with a ragged old bra in her hands, and asks her husband if she can have $10 so she can go buy a new one. The husband then sarcastically asks, "What do you need a new bra for? You haven't got anything to put in it." To which the wife replies, "You wear a jock strap, don't you?" Ba-dum-bump. Can I Do It, Til I Need Glasses has loads of female nudity, including a few full frontal nude shots that were probably quite scandalous back in the 70s. The sensibility of filmgoers today is quite different, of course, and the nudity in Can I Do It, pubic regions notwithstanding, would actually be viewed as rather tame by today's standards. Can I Do It was a sequel to the film If You Don't Stop It, You'll Go Blind, which also consisted of a series of juvenile, risque sex skits, and which some of the characters in Can I Do It go see at the theater. The title Can I Do It Til I Need Glasses is the punchline to an old joke about masturbation. A father bursts in on his son flogging his baloney and warns him that if he keeps that up, he'll go blind. The son stops mid-stroke and asks his father if he can just do it until he needs glasses. The first skit Robin appears in takes place in a courtroom about 35 minutes into the film. He is a Los Angeles prosecutor in a divorce case who is charged with questioning a woman named Lucretia Frisbee, whose lurid sexual escapades have shocked the nation. After Mrs. Frisbee is sworn in, Robin steps up, wearing slicked down hair, tiny round glasses, and a black bow tie, and asks his first and only question. Prosecutor. Is it true, Mrs. Frisbee, that last summer you had sexual intercourse with a red-headed midget during a thunderstorm while riding nude in the sidecar of a Kawasaki motorcycle, performing an unnatural act on a Polish plumbing contractor, going 60 miles an hour up and down the steps of the Washington Monument on the night of July 14th? Is that true, Mrs. Frisbee? Is that true? Mrs. Frisbee. Could you repeat that date again, please? Robin then turns and looks right into the camera with a bemused look of exasperation on his face. And that ends this first skit, which runs a total of less than 1.5 minutes. Robin's second appearance in Can I Do It is in a 30-second skit that takes place in the hallway of an office building. Robin plays a hick in the big city with a toothache who needs a dentist desperately. The suspendered country boy waits, with his jaw wrapped in a red bandana, outside a doctor's office, which has a giant tooth hanging over its door. When Dr. Fisher finally arrives, Robin says,
"Oh, thank goodness you're here, Doc. I'm new in this town, and this tooth is killing me."
"Your tooth?" the doctor replies. "I'm afraid you've made a mistake, young man. I'm not a dentist. I'm a gynecologist." The hick is surprised and says, "A gynecologist? What you got that big tooth outside your office for?" To which the impatient doctor testily responds, "Schmuck, what did you expect me to hang up there?" A couple of sources consulted for information about this film claim that Robin was not in the original film, and that his two brief appearances were added to the film when Mork and Mindy became a huge hit. This may be true, since Robin's name appears nowhere in the opening or closing credits, and the only way he is acknowledged is at the very end of the credits when they flash his picture with the words, "And of course, Robin Williams." Robin probably regretted his two brief appearances in Can I Do It because this movie was technically his feature film debut, and after suffering through it for over an hour, one can easily understand why he wouldn't want that fact on his resume. It is a unique milestone in his career, though, and if you're a real Robin Williams fan, the film is worth a rental just to see what all the hubbub is about. FYI, this movie has collectible status, so the prices to buy are high. At this writing, spring 2020, eBay has it new from $55 to $225. Amazon has used copies ranging from $134.95 to $198.99. Popeye, 1980. "I ain't no doctor, but I know I'm losing my patience." Popeye. Popeye is a strange yet immensely enjoyable movie. Robin Williams chose it as his major motion picture acting debut, which was a bold decision considering the inevitable risks in trying to use human actors to bring three-dimensional life to a cartoon character. Sometimes it works. Batman, 1989. Superman, 1978. Dick Tracy, 1990, The Flintstones, 1994, and The Crow, 1994, come immediately to mind. Sometimes it doesn't. The Addams Family, 1992, Annie, 1982, Dennis the Menace, 1993, Howard the Duck, 1986, and Brenda Starr, 1992, are examples of how this kind of adaptation can often fail. In 1979, Robin was flying high as the irrepressible alien Mork from Ork in the successful TV series Mork and Mindy, and it seemed a given that he would easily be able to make the move to theatrical films. He chose a project that would appear to be a surefire winner. Popeye was based on a beloved character, who had been a ubiquitous presence in both the comic strips and animated cartoons for decades. The script was by the renowned writer and playwright Jules Pfeiffer, Carnal Knowledge, 1971, and the film's director was the respected and successful Robert Altman, whose previous films had included MASH, 1970, Nashville, 1975, and A Wedding, 1978. There is a lot to like about Popeye. First of all, it is extremely funny. Some of the more memorable gags include Robin's flawless rendering of the way Popeye speaks. "You got a room for rink?" as well as his meticulous recreation of Popeye's physical movements, including a dance-like double step when he walks. Also notable is his amazing facial work, particularly the way he keeps his right eye squinted shut all the time. How did he do that anyway? And his rubbery expressions. In a January 1992 Playboy interview, Robin said of his Popeye face, "I felt like a guy robbing a bank with a condom on his head." Other funny bits in the film include Olive Oil's mother, Mrs. Oil, insisting on addressing Popeye as Mr. I, the town of Sweet Haven having a 50-cent up-to-no-good tax, and the scene in which Popeye talks to a picture of his father, which we soon see is really the words, "me papa," in a picture frame. Later, this joke is echoed when we see Poop Deck Pappy, Popeye's father, talking to a picture of his long-lost son that, yes, consists of the words, "me son," in a picture frame. The sets in Popeye, which was filmed on the island of Malta, a place Robin described to Playboy as like San Quentin on Valium, are amazing. Sweet Haven is a wharf town you'd never see on any real coastline, and yet the place works. The interiors combine crazy assortments of furniture and stuff that the players work like props. Harry Nilsson's songs at first seem so minimalist in melody that they come across almost as non-songs. But after hearing a few bars of them, especially Olive's "He's Large" and Popeye's "I Am What I Am," they exert a kind of hypnotic effect that contributes to the overall surrealistic feel of the film. This unreal quality, so present in the movie, requires some adjustments to a viewer's normal viewing expectations. Cartoon violence is depicted realistically. A huge floor lamp is picked up and wrapped around a guy's neck, and Popeye's ubiquitous pipe spins like a dervish when he gets excited, just like in the cartoon. And in the lagoon scene towards the end of the film, Popeye submerges himself and watches Bluto from beneath the water, using his pipe as a more than adequate periscope. Popeye does not put a camp spin on the character or his world. The cast and crew simply present his world, and we are immediately swept up in its unique oddness. Overall, Popeye succeeds primarily because of this singular commitment to playing it straight. Granted, it's a peculiar film, but Robin Williams does a good job of creating a flesh and blood character out of something that had previously been only paper and ink. Some interesting cast details from this film. Popeye is one of the first screen appearances of NYPD Blues Dennis Franz. He plays a rowdy tough who gets beaten up by Popeye. The mayor of Sweet Haven is played by Richard Libertini, who later worked with Robin in Awakenings. Contortionist Bill Irwin, who later had a recurring role in the TV series Northern Exposure, as the carnival performer who wouldn't talk, appears as a Sweet Haven resident whose body is squashed by Bluto. And Cindy, the drudge, is played by none other than Robin's then-wife, Valerie Velarde. Robin needed to spend an hour and a half each day having his makeup applied before being put in the latex forearms. These arms were so tight, they would cut off the circulation to his real arms, necessitating periods of downtime to remove the arms and let all the muscles in Robin's own shoulders and arms relax back to normal. What Robin had to say. Popeye was a nice fairy tale with a loving spirit to it, and I think most people, especially movie critics, were expecting a combination of Superman and a Busby Berkeley musical. In the end, I think that what Altman got was a very gentle fable with music and a lot of heart. From Playboy, October 1982. What the critics had to say. Roger Ebert. Popeye is lots of fun. It suggests that it is possible to take the broad strokes of a comic strip and turn them into sophisticated entertainment. What's needed is the right attitude toward the material. If Altman and his people had been the slightest bit condescending toward Popeye, the movie might have crash-landed. But it's clear that this movie has an affection for Popeye, and so much regard for the Sailor Man, that it even bothers to reveal the real truth about his opinion of spinach. From his review on CompuServe. Leonard Maltin. A game cast does its best with Jules Pfeiffer's unfunny script, Altman's cluttered staging, and some alleged songs by Harry Nilsson. Tune in an old Max Fleischer cartoon instead. You'll be much better off. From his movie and video guide. Video Hound's Golden Movie Retriever. Williams accomplishes the near impossible feat of physically resembling the title character. And the whole movie does accomplish the maker's stated goal of looking like a comic strip, but it isn't anywhere near as funny as it should be. From the 1997 edition. Tom Weiner. Williams is good, but Altman can't seem to find the handle on the material. From his The Book of Video Lists. Barbara Walters. Popeye is the kind of movie that ruins great careers and marks talented people as box office poison. From a 1989 Barbara Walters special on ABC. The World According to Garp, 1982. It really has been an adventure. T.S. Garp. On the day we started shooting Garp, I improvised a line and director George Roy Hill called a wrap for the set. I thought, okay, you've made your point. I won't do that again. Robin Williams in the October 1982 issue of Playboy. Perhaps we should consider The World According to Garp as Robin Williams's real film debut, Popeye notwithstanding. In defense of this suggestion is the fact that Popeye was such a strange film, it can justifiably be looked at as more of a movie-slash-pop-culture experience existing outside the normal parameters of dramatic or comedic filmmaking. After all, Robin was playing a cartoon character, an endeavor that brought with it a history of behaviors and background details requiring that Robin color inside the lines, so to speak. Popeye is Popeye. There's not a lot of leeway in interpreting the character. The World According to Garp, on the other hand, was Robin's first serious role as an actor playing a real person in the real world. Granted, Garp's universe is also somewhat strange, peopled as it is with transsexual football players, self-mutilating feminists, and a pre-disastered home. Robin convinces his wife to buy a house because, as he tells her, the odds of another plane crashing into it are astronomical. But Robin Williams gets to play T.S. Garp straight. There's hardly a hint of his manic stand-up comedic persona, except for one brief scene in which he plays Warrior with his kids and Roberta, the tight-end transsexual. And Robin truly astonishes with the brilliant shading and nuances he brings to the role. The World According to Garp begins with the story of a nurse named Jenny Fields, Garp's mother. Jenny conceives Garp by having sex with a brain-dead patient in the military hospital where she was stationed during World War II. One of the side effects of Technical Sergeant Garp's brain injury was a permanent erection, which the child-craving Jenny put to good use one night after the lights were out. Jenny names her son T.S. Garp after his father and raises him unconventionally, treating him at a very early age like an adult with whom she can be completely forthcoming and honest about all manner of subjects, including, of course, sex. After an odd childhood at the Everett Steering Boarding School, Jenny was the resident nurse at the school, Jenny moves herself and Garp to New York, where she becomes intrigued by Garp's fascination with the hookers that line the streets. She befriends one young girl, talks to her about her life, and buys her for her son. And Jenny's relationship with the girl inspires Jenny to write an autobiographical feminist tract called Sexual Suspect, which becomes one of the biggest bestsellers of all time and transforms Jenny into a cult figure, loved by some and hated by many. Garp, meantime, has been working to find his own authorial voice, and his first novel, Procrastination, is published to less than stellar sales. This milestone, however, persuades Helen Holm, the love of Garp's life, to marry him. She swore she would only marry a real writer, and they have their first child, Duncan. As Jenny's fame and its attendant danger to her grows, Jenny retreats from the city and converts her family beach house into a retreat for battered women, rape victims, and Ellen Jamesians. Ellen James was an 11-year-old girl who was abducted and raped by older men who cut out her tongue so she wouldn't talk. Ellen Jamesians were men-hating women who had their own tongues surgically removed in tribute to Ellen. Garp's life becomes a succession of days of domesticity and writing. Helen leaves the house each day to go teach at graduate school, and Garp stays home and does the laundry, cooks, takes care of the kids, and writes. Tragedy is a constant in Garp's life, however, and true happiness seems to deliberately evade him. Terrible events dog him, including an airplane crashing into his house, flown by Garp director George Roy Hill in a cameo appearance, an assassination attempt on his mother, an adulterous affair between his wife and one of her graduate students, and an affair between him and an 18-year-old babysitter. But the worst thing to happen to him is an auto accident that breaks his jaw, puts his wife in a neck brace, blinds one eye of his son, Duncan, and most tragically, takes the life of his youngest son, Walt. The pivotal event that caused the terrible series of tragedies was Garp's car crashing into the car of his wife's lover, Michael Milton, as Helen was performing farewell fellatio on him in the front seat. The force of the crash causes Helen to bite down and amputate Michael's penis. The reason Garp hit the car with such force was because he had turned off the engine and the lights and was coasting into the driveway at a high rate of speed. He liked to do this because, he said, it felt like flying. Flying is an important theme running throughout the world according to Garp, and it is significant that the movie begins and ends with Garp flying, first in and out of his mother's arms, and later in a helicopter after a crazed Ellen Jamesian shoots him 3 times in the chest. The world according to Garp ends, sadly, with 2 dreadful events. The first is the assassination of Garp's mother. The second, the assassination attempt on Garp himself. Jenny is shot by an anti-feminist zealot. Garp is shot by an anti-male radical. Interestingly, the world according to Garp provided Robin with his first opportunity to dress in drag. The classic Mrs. Doubtfire wouldn't come for another decade. In order for Garp to attend the women-only feminist memorial service for his mother, Roberta, the transsexual John Lithgow, dresses Garp as a woman so he can attend the ceremony. Garp's former next-door neighbor, the sexually repressed Ellen Jamesian Pooh, spots him and screams, "Arp!" That's all she could get out without a tongue. Pooh later sneaks into Garp's wrestling class and shoots him point blank. The world according to Garp is a layered, metaphorically complex morality tale that works on many levels and which provides Robin Williams with a role that is as rich and textured as some of his important later roles in such films as Awakenings and Dead Poets Society. It is both a serious drama and a sardonic black comedy at the same time. Wouldn't it have been interesting if Garp had been Robin's first feature film role, followed by Popeye and then the others? Would Popeye have been savaged by the critics the way it was if it followed Robin's superb performance in The World According to Garp? Bizarre Epilogue. It is truly a strange world when a Robin Williams movie can figure into, of all things, the O.J. Simpson civil trial. In November of 1996, Cato Kalin was called to testify in the civil trial against O.J., brought by the families of murder victim Nicole Brown Simpson and Ronald Goldman. And during Kalin's testimony, he revealed that the day before the slayings, he and O.J. had watched the Robin Williams movie The World According to Garp. When the movie got to the scene in which Garp's wife, Helen, performs oral sex on one of her graduate students in the front seat of his car and subsequently bites off his erection, Kalin said that O.J. talked about how the scene reminded him of the time he spied on his wife, Nicole, performing oral sex on one of her boyfriends in April of 1992. O.J. surreptitiously watched the two have sex through a window of Nicole's condo. This incident prompted a huge fight between Nicole and O.J. in October of 1993 that resulted in the infamous 911 call that brought several police officers to Nicole's home. What Robin had to say. The world according to Garp was like an oil drilling. I had to dig down and find things deep inside myself and then bring them up. Heavy griefs and joys, births and deaths. Garp is an all-encompassing look at a man's life. From Playboy, October 1982. What the critics had to say. Roger Ebert. While I watched Garp, I enjoyed it. I thought the acting was unconventional and absorbing, especially by Williams, by Glenn Close as his mother, and by John Lithgow as a transsexual. I thought the visualization of the events by director George Roy Hill was fresh and consistently interesting. But when the movie was over, my immediate response was not at all what it should have been. All I could find to ask myself was, what the hell was that all about? From his review on CompuServe. Leonard Moulton. The world according to Garp is an absorbing, sure-footed odyssey through vignettes of social observation, absurdist humor, satire, and melodrama. Beautifully acted by all, especially Close, in her feature debut as Garp's mother, and Lithgow as a transsexual. From his movie and video guide. The Survivors, 1983. You know, I never had a friend like you. Donald Quinnell. Robin Williams' 1983 film The Survivors came with a fairly impressive pedigree. In its favor was the following. 1. The Survivors was an original script and the feature film debut for Emmy Award-winning writer Michael Leeson, who had written a great deal of TV, including episodes of The Partridge Family, The Odd Couple, Happy Days, The Mary Tyler Moore Show, Rhoda, Taxi, and The Cosby Show, and who would later script 1989's biting and hilarious divorce comedy-slash-drama, The War of the Roses, starring Kathleen Turner, Michael Douglas, and Danny DeVito. 2. The Survivors was directed by Michael Ritchie, who had previously helmed such memorable flicks as The Candidate, 1972, Smile, 1975, The Bad News Bears, 1976, and Semi-Tough, 1977. 3, and perhaps most significantly, The Survivors starred three major talents in the film industry. Veteran actor Walter Matthau, a genius at creating meticulously crafted characters, often through nothing more than the raise of an eyebrow or a flawlessly timed glance. The 1980s country music superstar Jerry Reed, who proved that he was even a better actor than a singer-songwriter. And of course, Robin Williams, who had just come off a phenomenally successful run on Mork and Mindy, as well as two truly unique films, Popeye and The World According to Garp. So with all this high-priced talent and Hollywood history in its favor, does The Survivors work? Well, yes, it does. Sort of. The Survivors was extremely topical when it was released in 1983. As recently as November of 1982, the United States had been in the midst of a raging recession. Unemployment was the highest it had been, 10.8%, since 1940, and paranoia gripped our land like an iron hand. The survivors mined this fertile socioeconomic territory by telling the story of three disparate characters, all of whom found themselves in dire financial difficulty, and whose paths crossed in an unlikely turn of events that, frankly, could probably only really happen in a movie script. Donald Quinnell, Robin Williams, is a mid-level manager who is confident that he is on the fast track to corporate success. He's a three-piece suit kind of guy who drives the same station wagon to work that all his colleagues at the same level also drive. One morning, he is summoned to company president Mr. Stoddard's office, and he rushes there eagerly. He thinks he is in line for some big promotion or some other well-deserved accolade from the big man himself. He is greeted, instead, by an empty office and a parrot. The parrot, whom Mr. Stoddard spent months personally training, looks at Donald and tells him, "You have been a valuable asset to this company, so this is not easy for me to say. You're fired." At first, Donald thinks it's a joke, but when Mr. Stoddard's secretary pulls a gun on him and calls him an ungrateful turd, he knows it's for real. Donald leaves the building shell-shocked and thus isn't really paying attention when he stops at Sonny's service station to fill up his car's gas tank. His former company generously allowed him to use the company car through the end of the month. Donald distractedly misses his car's gas spout with the nozzle and instead pumps at least 10 gallons of gasoline all over the ground. He gets in the car and drives off, and then, through his rear window, we see the entire gas station explode into a raging inferno, thanks to a carelessly thrown cigarette dropped by none other than the gas station's owner, Sonny Peluso, Walter Matthau. This catastrophe puts Sonny out of business and ends up being the pivotal event that throws him and Donald together. Donald and Sonny both end up at the unemployment office, where Sonny gets maced by an Indian civil servant when he refuses to accept that he cannot collect unemployment because he was a business owner, and where Donald spends hours in line trying to make sense of the ramblings of a well-dressed man who speaks nothing but Spanish. After their experiences with the unemployment system, the two of them both end up at the Pit Stop Diner, where Donald sits at the counter weeping while Sonny continuously wipes his inflamed, maced eye. The third member of the motley triumvirate that makes up the survivors, professional hitman Jack Locke, Jerry Reed, chooses this moment to hold up the diner, and he does so wearing a ski mask and speaking in an ethnic dialect. Donald and Sonny have been pushed just a tad too far today, however, and being held up is apparently the final insult. Sonny grabs Jack's gun, and it goes off. Donald gets shot in the arm, and Jack's mask comes off in Sonny's hand. Jack flees the diner, and Donald ends up in the hospital where he is forced to endure a TV editorial blasting him for his foolish heroics and calling him and Sonny hotshots with dumb luck. The robbery was a defining moment for Donald, however, and he decides to go on TV and issue a rebuttal to the editorial during which he mentions Sonny Peluso by name. Jack happens to be watching Donald as he blathers on and on about the Constitution, while also offering a few ludicrous observations. The root cause of crime is criminals. Jack, hunting for both Donald and Sonny, eliminate the witnesses is, after all, the first rule of good crimesmanship, is able to track down Sonny after learning his last name. Jack shows up at Sonny's house to kill him. Donald arrives to apologize for saying Sonny's name on TV. They hit Jack in the head with a trophy, and they take him to the police station where he is arrested. On the way home, Donald makes Sonny stop at a gun store where he buys enough artillery to arm his own private army. Donald also signs up for a survivalist retreat where he will learn how to defend himself against the marauding vermin that will be everywhere when society ultimately collapses. This is where the survivors falters. The remainder of the movie is a convoluted and unlikely chain of events in which Jack gets out on bail and forces Sonny to take him to the survivalist camp. He wants to kill Donald because Donald knows that he was the one who disappeared Jimmy Hoffa in 1975, even though Jack admits that he made that story up because no one else was taking credit, so he figured, what the hell? The scenes at the camp are slow-paced and forced. Robin's character devolves from a poor sap dumped on by a cruel economy into a cartoon soldier who seems to have lost all grounding in reality and has transformed himself into a militaristic buffoon. Walter Matthau is, as always, superb. And to be fair, Robin does have some funny moments, and he does what he can with the character. But the scenario is so far-fetched and poorly paced that we cannot suspend our disbelief and simply enjoy the wacky antics of the survivors, as we were able to with something like the comedy Stripes, a movie with an equally bizarre and unlikely series of events, but one which, nonetheless, allowed us to enjoy its characters and storylines anyway. There are some interesting elements in The Survivors, including a few Robin Williams one-liners, such as, "He has a face like somebody in the road company of Deliverance." Does this make you realize men have nipples too? A professional killer with colitis? They must hear you coming. And, "Oh God, I love the smell of Malamute in the morning." It's likely that those lines were not part of the original script, but were instead improvised during shooting by the inimitable Mr. Williams. Roseanne's TV husband, John Goodman, in one of his earliest screen roles, plays one of the fanatical survivalists. The Survivors has what you could call a happy ending, although it is an anemic conclusion to what can only be described as an average script. The ending? Donald takes off his clothes in the snow because he's freaked out by his depressing lot in life. Walter Matthau reassures him and calms him down, and the three of them, now friends, drive off down a snowy road after they successfully escape the bloodthirsty survivalists. An interesting bit of cinematic synchronicity. There is a scene in The Survivors, quoted in the epigraph to this chapter, that will resonate with Robin Williams' fans, who also saw Aladdin. In The Survivors, Robin's character tells Walter Matthau's character, "You know, I never had a friend like you," which is very similar to what Robin's character, Genie, tells Aladdin. "You ain't never had a friend like me," in the movie Aladdin, which came out almost 10 years later. What the critics had to say. Mick Martin and Marcia Porter. Generally a black comedy, this movie features a variety of comedic styles, and they all work, from their video movie guide. Leonard Moulton. Survivors is combination black comedy and social satire. Likeable stars do their best with a scattershot script. From his movie and video guide. Roger Ebert. The story gets so confused that the movie can't even account for why its characters happen to be in the same place at the same time. In desperation, it gives us a scene where Williams actually calls Reed and tells him where he can be found. Uh-huh. From his movie Home Companion. Moscow on the Hudson, 1984. America is magnificent. Vladimir Ivanov. I have a defector. We're between Estee Lauder and Pierre Cardin. Bloomingdale security guard, Lionel Witherspoon. Moscow on the Hudson tells the story of a Russian saxophonist named Vladimir Ivanov, who plays in the Russian circus and who defects to the U.S. during a visit to New York City. Robin Williams plays Vladimir Ivanov flawlessly. He easily communicates the meek and timid demeanor so common to immigrants and makes us feel what it must be like for someone from a foreign country to suddenly have to make sense of our often chaotic culture and labyrinthine bureaucratic agencies. The movie begins in Russia, where we see how people lived before the collapse of the Soviet Union's communist government. There is a macabre fascination for many of us in these early scenes set in Russia, and some telling moments stand out. For instance, citizens walking through the streets of Moscow would automatically get into a line they saw forming, no matter what the line was for. These lines often snaked around entire city blocks, and they usually meant that some merchant had gotten a shipment of some kind of commodity. It could be toilet paper or shoes. It didn't matter. The Russians would get into that line. In one of these scenes, Robin's character finds that the line he is in is for shoes. When he gets to the front of the line, he learns that they do not have either of the pairs he wants in his size. No matter, he buys two pairs that are several sizes smaller because he knows he can trade them for something else he can actually use. In another scene, as Robin and his circus clown friend Boris are driving through Moscow, they see a truck parked under a bridge and immediately know that the driver has black market gasoline for sale. They make a U-turn and stop. The most revealing moment in this scene then occurs when they open their trunk and take out two large containers for the gasoline. In Russia, one has to always be prepared to take advantage of any opportunity that might come one's way. This element of Soviet life is hammered home again when another car pulls up to the truck and its driver likewise.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.